And we're back. So we've already drawn some one-point shapes that are seen from the outside of the box, but now we're going to be putting ourselves inside the box so that we can start to construct room interiors. And this may feel a little bit confusing to start with, so I've included this photograph down in the bottom corner so you kind of understand what we're talking about by putting ourselves inside the box. What happens now, instead of starting with the surface of the box that's closest to us like we did for the last few drawings, we're going to be starting with the back wall of the room. And it's important that this rectangle encloses our central vanishing point. So if you don't have this on your drawing already, pretty much every drawing we do in perspective, I'm going to have you start with a horizon line more or less through the middle of your page. I think mine's slightly above the halfway point just so that I have a little more room to draw the ground plane of my interior, but it's okay to have it right through the middle if you want to as well. It's going to crowd your floor a little bit, but it's not a big deal. So when we're starting to think about where to place that rectangle, what I want you to do is think about the eye level of the person that's in that room. So if we were to make the ceiling really close to our horizon line or our eye level, what that's going to make it feel like is that the room ceiling is really low and it's kind of a claustrophobic space. If you're drawing a room that is a big commercial space, like let's say the interior of a church or some big public building that may have 20 or 30 foot high ceilings, then you could make your ceiling really pretty high above the horizon line and make less space below there. But for a more intimate house interior, like a bedroom, or if you're drawing a living room, you might think about how tall the ceilings really are in the space that you're drawing, and think about the eye level as sort of representing the height of where the eyes would be of someone standing in that room. So let's say we just kind of sketch out a little person here. Think about, for many of us, our eye level might be somewhere around the 5 foot level. I'm about 5'6", and so my eyes probably are right about 5 feet off the ground plane. And then I'm thinking about, okay, well, if this is where the back wall might be, the floor of that room, how tall would the ceiling be? And if I'm 5.5 foot tall, maybe the ceilings are 7 or 8 feet tall. So you can kind of estimate how big that back wall would need to be to fit this person in there. So I'm going to go ahead and draw in a rectangle. I'm going to use my horizon line as a reference for what level, what horizontal is going to be. And I want to make sure we have plenty of room for the walls, so I'm going to make this back wall pretty tiny. It is going to be surrounding the vanishing point. That's really important that the vanishing point is inside this rectangle that we're drawing. And I'm also going to make it not so symmetrical, so I want to show you what happens when the vanishing point is not right in the center of the back wall, because it does affect the way these angles come out. So I'm going to intentionally kind of keep my vanishing point a little closer to one side wall than the other wall. So these are, I've used two vertical lines and two horizontal lines to construct this back wall of the room. And we're going to expect some distortion as we get farther and farther toward the edges of our page. We just can't really avoid it. It would be great if we had a much bigger piece of paper to work on, but if I work much smaller than this, you're not going to be able to see what's happening in my drawing, so I have to compromise. So remember, when we drew our boxes from the outside, we went from these points back to some central vanishing point. Now that we're inside the box, we're actually going to be still looking at these four corners, but instead of extending the lines backwards and drawing that part in, we're going to be drawing the part of the line that comes out towards us. So it's almost like we're working in reverse. So start at the central vanishing point, and then from each one of these four corners, we're going to be extending lines outward toward the edges of our page to construct the walls and the ceiling. Now pay attention that these angles are not just simply 45 degree angles. They're all vanishing lines. They all align with that central vanishing point, and the angle is determined by the central vanishing point. It's not just a 45 degree angle. It must be a vanishing line. So suddenly, we have constructed this kind of deep room, and we have two side walls, we have the ceiling, we have the floor. We're inside the room. Can everybody see that? Now, some of the most basic things we need to be able to do is cut holes in the wall to create doors and windows. And I want to show you how to make a second room. So we're going to pretend that we're cutting a hole in the side wall, and we use the same principle we used when we were cutting holes in the boxes that we had floating above our heads and that we turned into the shed and the little clubhouse up on stilts. And so the same principle applies. First, let's cut a doorway in the back wall. That's a little bit easier because it's not moving away from us into space. And we do want to think about a doorway that would fit this little person that we've kind of imagined as sort of our size, our height. So I'm going to shift this doorway off. If we cut the doorway right around this person, we'd be able to see the thickness of the walls on both sides of the opening. If we draw it off to one side, we're only going to be able to see the thickness on the side of the opening that's further away from the vanishing point. So let's try one off to the side, and then I'm going to show you how we can project that height onto our side walls so that the doors that we cut into the side of the room also in real life would have doorways of the same height as the one that we first cut into the back wall. So let's do the one on the back wall first. Do your best to try to keep those verticals truly vertical. And I'm going to make my door a little bit narrower than a standard door would probably be. And I want to make sure that the top of the doorway is tall enough that this person can fit through it easily. It's a pretty small room. Okay, so we've cut a hole, and this wall has no depth to it yet. It feels like it's maybe paper thin, so we need to show that these walls are made out of drywall and have, you know, let's imagine that it's maybe 6 inches thick in real life. So what we're going to need to do now is we need to, from the two sides, again, since this is on a flat wall, we're going to be looking at the two corners that are farther from the vanishing point. So I'm going to put a dot there so that you know which ones we're talking about. And we're going to be extending vanishing lines to our central vanishing point. So I'll draw this as a dotted line just so you're sure that you're paying attention, that these are not just random angles that we're drawing, but they are vanishing lines. And this is another situation where we want to make sure we get those vanishing lines in before we start deciding how thick we want the walls to be that we're cutting that doorway through. So I'm going to decide on the side wall first, so you can pick any depth you want, and then once you decide the side wall, then wherever that line, that vertical line, intersects this vanishing line that's at the top of the door, that is where we'll add one more line that echoes what happens here. This was a horizontal line, so we just draw a second horizontal line right at that intersection point. There's a good chance that the thickness at the top of the door is going to be a little bit different thickness than it is at the side, and that is perfectly normal. If you force this to be the same size as this, that's going to force this to be a 45 degree angle, which is not the right angle. It needs to be leading to the vanishing point. So I'll be checking these things and I'll be marking off points if these are not leading to your vanishing point. That's really critical. I'm going to look for this line at the bottom of the doorway and at the top to both lead toward that central vanishing point. Now let's pretend that we've got wall-to-wall carpeting in this room that extends into the second room. And let's pretend there's a second room back there instead of just some big void that you disappear into. So in order to make this second room feel like it's sharing the same wall as this room that we're in, we need to extend this original line that we had into this opening now. So I'm going to line up my ruler with that original line, make sure it's leading to the vanishing point, and only in the area that's been cut away, I'm going to go ahead and draw that in. And we would be able to see the point where the ceiling meets the wall through that room too. And I'm going to erase this dotted line since we don't need it anymore. Now notice that these lines that I've drawn don't have to correspond to this. You know, there's a situation where it might happen to line up depending how big you made your doorway and how far it was from the vanishing point. But normally this inner line has nothing to do with this line. It has everything to do with this line instead. So this line and this line must both lead to the vanishing point, should be the same line. But this line that shows the thickness of the doorway is a totally different issue. Now, if we wanted to create, instead of feeling like this is a mile long hallway that goes on forever, if we want to show the back wall, we could decide how deep we want that room to be. You know, it could be any point along there. And we could add the back wall of the second room with a vertical line and two horizontal lines. And that would suggest that there's another room back in there. Try to keep this as truly horizontal as I can. And we'd see a tiny bit at the top of the ceiling. You may or may not be able to see that top of the ceiling depending on where you draw this back wall. It may look a little bit different. And again, it's getting a little confusing because we've got a lot of lines in here, but if you want to try to really emphasize that sense of depth, you could use your kneaded eraser and lighten the contours that are in that second room. You still want them to be solid lines because we could see it, but maybe lighten up the line weight a little bit so that it recedes back into space a little bit better. And then you could darken this one up by retracing it. So now we have a second room back there, another little bedroom or kitchen or whatever you want that to be, but we're seeing it through this end wall. So now we're gonna try a cool trick that allows us to figure out exactly how tall the doors would need to be on the side wall. So what we can do is we can extend an imaginary horizontal line across the top of the doorway. Try to keep it as parallel to this other horizontal line as you can so that you're not distorting things. And wherever that dotted line touches the side wall, I'm going to put a dot there so you know what I'm looking for. From these points, now that these walls are coming out at us in space, we're going to be having to use the central vanishing point again to extend the top of the doorway onto these side walls. So there's been a plane change right here at the corner. And so we no longer can just follow across the horizontal lines. We need to use the foreshortened lines, the vanishing lines, to help us project those guidelines out into the room towards us. So in both of these cases, I'm lining it up from the central vanishing point through that point where the top of the door hits the side wall. And then from that point, it needs to slope upwards into the room. It should be getting bigger and bigger and bigger as it gets towards us. In the photograph that's in the lower left corner here, you can see they did a similar thing with the windows on the side wall there. So they're angling downward as they approach that back wall. So it's a little hard to judge how wide these doors need to be, but realize we're seeing them kind of from the side angle. So you're not going to make them as fat as they look when they're back here, even though they're getting closer to us and they're getting larger. You know, try to keep them pretty skinny looking so that they don't seem distorted. They'll get really distorted as we get out here. So we're going to try to keep the doors kind of back toward that central area, and hopefully we won't see too much warping. So you can pick a point anywhere along here. That door could slide out and be really tall if it's out here. As it moves back, it gets shorter and shorter until it gets to that height of the door on the back wall. So I'm going to pick a point. Well, why don't we put one on this wall just for change? And I'm lining up my ruler as carefully as I can with I see the faint guidelines underneath from the grid paper that's underneath my paper. And that's the first side of the door. It's a little bit warped, even though I tried. Stay straight. Let me use my triangle instead. It'll be a little bit more accurate. Let's see the best way to do this. Maybe like this. Or maybe a little square in this case. And I'm just sort of estimating for the second side of the door. And then I'll darken in that top of the door. So this is the initial hole that we're going to be cutting. It still feels super flat. We don't have any sense of the depth of the wall yet, so we need to add that in next. And again, if you're confused and you're not sure where to try to angle these lines that show the depth, look back at the two types of line that you've already used. So since this wall was constructed using vanishing lines and vertical lines, that's what I used when I cut the opening. So we're still using vanishing lines, and we used two verticals. So we have not used our horizontal lines yet. So that means from this point and this point, we're going to be extending a true horizontal line, you know, parallel to the horizon, straight across. Let me start at my horizon, just kind of shift down. Try to keep that parallel to the horizon. And I'm just going to have to estimate how thick that wall would be. I know that this part of the wall is closer to me than that part, but this part's also foreshortened. So it's a little bit of a guessing game trying to estimate how thick to make that wall. I know there are some ways we can do that with quite a bit more measuring, but so that we can get through a little bit more of the drawing, we're going to just estimate for today. So this is the side plane. Just if we were kind of looking at this door, it would be sort of this area of the door that we've constructed using horizontals and verticals. We did it a little bit different because we're on a different plane now, right? So from this point that's left over, see how incomplete this feels up here? We need to add one more line, and it needs to be running the same direction toward the same vanishing point as this first part where we made the initial cut in the wall. So this is a vanishing line. This is not just a random angle that it has to go from the central vanishing point through that point that we just found and then extend it until it disappears behind this side of the doorway. So if we had wall-to-wall carpeting going into that second room, we could also erase this line. If, let's say, this is carpeted, but we want that to look like it's a wooden floor or a vinyl floor, you could leave a line there. So here's another approach. I guess we'll just add that in as an option too. You could have a threshold that you step over. So I'm going to actually add a line that shows that there's some sort of change in the flooring. This could be like a little wooden piece of wood that you step over to get into this other room. And let's pretend that this side room is just as deep as the room that we're in. So instead of following this line from, you know, that second room behind it, we'll just extend this line into this opening so that it feels like the second room is sharing a wall with the room that we're in. So we would be able to see that line as a solid. There's a chance that depending on how large your door is and how far you drew it into the room, if you could see this line through the opening, you should draw it in as well. My doorway is a little bit too short, or it's too close to the back wall to be able to see that line continue into that room. But if your doorway is way up here and that line would be visible, go ahead and draw that in. Okay, that's a good basic start. And we'll be adding in some other objects into this room for the next drawing.